Yesterday was new Twitter CEO Parag Agrawal's first full day on the job, and the changes have already begun rolling out. The official Twitter safety account announced a new rule that will not allow the sharing of private media, such as image or videos, of private individuals without their consent. Publishing people's private info is also prohibited under the policy, as is threatening or incentivizing others to do so. According to Twitter's help site, content not in violation of the new policy includes contact information, including name, birth date, or age, place of education or employment, and screenshots of text messages or messages from other platforms. As for what qualifies as private media, Twitter says they will take into consideration whether the image is publicly available and/or is being covered by journalists, or if a particular image and the accompanying tweet text adds value to the public discourse, is being shared in public interest, or is relevant to the community.
Plenty of users shared their questions and concerns about what kind of content falls under the new rule. One user tweeted, quote, "Private videos of private individuals shared on Twitter is what got Rittenhouse acquitted." Another Twitter user said, "I can see this easily being abused to censor photos that have a genuine public interest." Team Rising is here to weigh in. Joe Caiazzo is a Democratic strategist, and Liz Wolf is an associate editor at Reason. Glad to have you both here.
Thanks.
Happy to be with you today.
So, Liz, what's your immediate reaction to this? Because you have to understand the kind of institutional politics of Twitter as well. Dorsey had some outside support as a founder, but Agrawal is going to need a lot of internal support in order to maintain his position. Do you feel like this new policy is more aimed at people internally or at an external audience?
Well, I'm extremely worried about what adds value to the public discourse means. They've offered no indication as to how that will be enforced, and I'm sort of a free speech maximalist. I see lots of things as potentially plausibly adding value to the public discourse. In terms of this being a matter of internal versus external dynamics, I mean, I'm really worried. Dorsey was, one of the tech CEOs that was trotted in front of Congress. I believe it was last winter. I mean, some people like Mark Zuckerberg were very much in favor of tweaking Section 230, the Internet's First Amendment. And Dorsey was sort of the one who was this resolute force against a lot of that. He was this really strong voice of reason who said basically the government should not be the Internet speech police. And frankly, a lot of these social media platforms really need to have a very expansive concept of what type of speech they'll allow on their platform. So Dorsey was sort of the lone voice of sanity in the room, especially as all these 75-year-olds in Congress trotted these tech CEOs in front of them and really just gave them such a hard time without understanding how these platforms work. So I'm pretty concerned about the departure of Dorsey, and I'm pretty concerned that this is a response to that and to attempting to appease internal forces within Twitter.
Joe, what do you make of this? Obviously, social media is having, this conversation right now about we have to police misinformation or harassment or bullying or those kinds of things. Actually, the new CEO got attacked on Twitter. He had his own like Twitter shaming mob coming after me moment for like past things he had even said on Twitter, which is, I guess, an experience that the CEO of the company should have. But do you think the company's going to, kind of steer a different course given how much criticism it's getting, well, from both sides, but especially from Democrats about its speech-related policies?
Yeah, that's a really great question. And look, I think that ultimately they will go in reverse course on this. I think that Twitter enjoys a lot of good capital, I guess, being at the forefront of booting off Trump and, starting some fact-checking and things along those lines. But I think at the end of the day, this is something that's critically important to our, democracy, and our society to be able to go and push these issues out there. We saw in the lead up to this, the Kyle Rittenhouse situation, along with, the other case down in Georgia, where, citizen journalists really participated in the process here that ultimately called out much of the bad behavior that is going on.
Well, and that's the issue with this policy, which I think is very confusing. And then they tried to explain it, and they had like a long explanation that I think made it more confusing. Because the making this distinction between like journalists and all other people doesn't really make sense, because everyone is a journalist. It's not an official. You don't need a license to be a journalist. And I get that they want to prohibit, like revenge porn, like sharing people's inappropriate photos or videos without their permission. I agree that that should be prohibited. I think social media sites
might be it's a crime in some states already.
Is a crime, although it's also been struck. It gets into a pretty interesting First Amendment territory. But it is a crime. But because of Section 230, it's not.
Right.
The site is not responsible. The person who did it can be held criminally liable, but not the site. So I understand wanting to clamp down on that kind of thing, but I'm reading this. It wasn't clear what if it's a private individual in a public setting? What if is this going to be the end of Liz? Is this going to be the end of like the Karen videos? Thing can no longer, maybe that would be a good thing. What do you think?
Well, I do think that was an interesting, implication that I was really thinking about. We saw the Amy Cooper Central Park Karen situation, and then soon after that, we saw Emma Sarley, which is a very similar situation, but a Brooklyn dog park. And the videos that surfaced of these events, although they initially, they led to these women being canceled and being really unfairly pilloried and some really horrible stuff. There was also some exculpatory evidence that emerged, in part because we allowed more and more citizen journalists to disseminate information about these initial encounters. I mean, I found this to be really the language that they used to roll this out. I found somewhat insulting and sort of like classic, annoying, woke jargon pandering. They were talking about how, these types of photos and videos that circulate of private individuals disproportionately hurt, women and minorities and dissidents. And I was looking at it and I was thinking, I'm not really hurt by, the dissemination of these images as a woman, but I would be hurt as a journalist if people crack down on this. It is important that upstart journalists and citizen journalists have really wide latitude to share their images widely. I don't think we should attempt to veer into attempting to decide who counts as a journalist and who doesn't. And I think, my co-panelists brought up the great point of the Ahmaud Arbery trial, the Kyle Rittenhouse trial, and the fact that the circulation of this type of evidence and this type of information is actually really important in terms of us making sense of what happened in a given situation.
And I would say that the Amy Cooper revisionism is a little bit lacking. Like, we could do a whole nother segment on that.
She wasn't at the other dog park one, which I think we talked about on the show. That one was pretty egregious.
Yes.
There was additional reporting. And also her life was just so ruined disproportionately to what happened, I thought.
Yes, but you can have a did the punishment fit the crime?
Yeah.
Revisionism?
Yeah.
But it was still a crime.
Yeah. Well, I don't know if it was a crime, but it was bad.
I'm using crime loosely.
Sure.
But it was bad. Anyway, Joe, what are some changes that Twitter is suggesting here that as far as you can understand them, that you feel like would actually be defensible kind of from a liberal perspective?
Look, at the end of the day, I think that, though this idea is seemingly well-intentioned by them, even though there are enormous problems with it, it's going to be nearly impossible to go and implement. It's going to be really tough to go and verify that everyone who is reporting a problem is actually that person who is going and reporting it. And I think at the end of the day, what you're doing is you're going and restricting the opportunity for people to be a part of our democracy and be a part of our media in a way that hasn't been available to us before the invent of social media and the camera phone.
Yeah, can you imagine Twitter trying to decide if like emerging private, quote unquote, private information is part of a story of legitimate public interest? That's going to be nuts.
I think it's impossible.
Yeah.
Who gets to decide what's news and what's not? Who gets to decide what's important and what's not? I totally and wholeheartedly think that we need to do everything possible to get fake news off of social media. But if we're going to start to go and restrict what the average person is able to go and post, how does that help us?
And also, if the bar is that your post has to contribute to the public discourse, most of my ish posting is going to be banned. I'm not contributing much.
That's it for you,
Twitter.
Ryan. That's it for you.
Sorry. Anyway, thank you guys so much for joining us, Liz, Joe.
Great to be with you today.
Thanks.
And we will have more Rising right after this.